Hello, and welcome to day two of my cruise along the middle-level navigations, which started with a hearty breakfast, the shreddies, not the super noodles. Mooring here is very limited. You can see not only did another boat have to stop on the lock landing overnight, but another one just tied to this random bit of bank, and yet another was half on the visitor mooring and half staked into the ground with mooring pins. Meanwhile, the weather looked gloomy. I set off by 8 a.m, hoping to be stopped and re-moored by late morning. The first task was to go through Ashline Lock, which is self-operated, but Andy, the owner of the boat moored behind me, very kindly came out to help. Andy opened the top sluices on one side, while I got to work on the other. They're very easy to open, but take about 60 turns of the handle. With the gate open and the sluices wound back down, yes, another 60 turns, I could hop back aboard and set off. Oddly, you're supposed to leave the lower gates open here, which saves you going back to close them.
Thanks very much!
There's a heck of a bywash here, which tries to push you off course as you leave, or coming the other way as you try to enter the lock, so you need to steer against it. There's the lock landing for coming the other way. No sooner have you fought the bywash than a railway bridge throws a challenge at you. Stay in the middle or you'll thump something. Not what I wanted to do on a borrowed boat. There was no sign of whatever it was I was avoiding. And then, no time to relax, as a weed whacker boat approached, telling me as he passed that he was one of three going by in quick succession. There's the second. They get a surprising clip-on for square-shaped boats. There was no sign of the third, presumably blown off course by the extraordinarily strong winds. Then suddenly there it was.
Morning.
On the opposite bank, a World War II pillbox, part of the country's defensive lines in case the Germans made it across the channel. Rather more modern are these wind turbines, which dot much of the local landscape. And another pillbox.
The plan for today is to get to the town of March, which the guidebook says is about 9 miles, or 3 hours cruising away.
Slightly disappointingly, the route to March is essentially two very long straight line sections, which are, if I'm honest, a tad boring. There is a four-way intersection to break up the trip though. This is Angle Corner, with the 20-foot river going left, and the splendidly named Beville's Leam to the right. This sign gives you the gist, and this aerial shot probably a better idea. That's 20-foot river on the left, the route I'm taking straight ahead, and branching off to the southwest is Beville's Leam. Unfortunately, I can't tell you who or what Beville was, or why that water is called a leam. Some things just are. That's the Leam from boat level. And this is not even the lowest bridge on the 20-foot river, so it was not a route I was going to try. Instead, I continued east. The other thing you find here is a more recent addition from the middle level commissioners, namely these wooden stakes, five in all, designed as a very basic mooring, if you can get close enough to fling a rope over the posts. The bank's not cut away at all, so it's shallow and muddy, not ideal for flat-bottomed narrowboats, but as you'll see in the next vlog, I did manage to get in here on the way back. All the nature around here was very shy. It kept hiding in the bushes. This bridge marks the start of a quick wiggle-wiggle, not a jiggle-jiggle, in the line of the otherwise straight path of the water. It was getting really windy. It's very deserted around here. Miles of open farmland and then the occasional house. It seems very isolated, but no noise from the neighbours, I suppose. Here's another of those rural moorings. There are about eight of these around the middle levels, providing a valuable complement to the proper visitor moorings. I was being fortified in my journey by these, which, as any right-thinking person knows, are actually opal fruits and always will be. Another pillbox. I'm slightly surprised these haven't been turned into modern luxury waterside apartments at £1 million apiece. There's another junction here, where the old route of the River Neen joins again and heads down towards the village of Ramsey. As before, I continued straight along towards March, and was a little over halfway there by this point. Interestingly, you cross the Greenwich Meridian here, longitude 0 degrees, in other words, going from the western to the eastern hemisphere. There's no ceremony, unlike crossing from north to south or vice versa. I felt even the tractor was sheltering from the wind. Here's what used to be called Flood's Ferry Marina, but is now apparently under new management and called Knightsbridge Marina, which sounds very posh. It's got chalets. And marina berths. And caravans. And a low bridge. If you build it, they will come. You see quite a few of these on your travels here. Water pumps. No surprise, since the middle levels were built for irrigation. Some narrowboats have private moorings here, or just tie up quietly where they can among the grasses. I did ponder whether I could do the same if needed, but the edges really don't lend themselves to tying up, especially single-handed in a strong breeze on a borrowed boat. This kind of sky makes me think an alien ship is about to land. Kudos to these kayakers in this breeze. Given how limited mooring is here, it's frustrating that the middle-level commissioners have this lovely spot, but it's reserved solely for their own workboats. A bit more of this kind of piling wouldn't go amiss. On the other hand, immediately after is a marina, where you can pay to use their pontoons if you wish. I did this on the way back. And here is the start of the town of March. Everybody on the water has a private garden mooring here. The shed is home to the Middle Level Watermen's Club, a group who years ago campaigned to rescue these waterways from decaying into oblivion. It's because of their efforts I could do this cruise. There's always a shopping trolley in every waterway. It is frustrating that the council-owned moorings here have been allowed to fall into a dangerous and unusable state. I love tiny narrowboats, and that looks great. I was nearly there. The boat you can see ahead is moored on some visitor moorings, but they're known to be absolutely covered in filthy goose poo, so ideally I'd want the next spot after that. Ew. Under the bridge, on the left, joy of joys, a space. I can't tell you what a relief this was. The only downside is that it's outside a pub, which can get noisy at night. But I didn't care. I was happy to have a spot, as the next one wouldn't be for miles further. And I even managed to leave space behind me for another. The final part of this cruise is in the next video. Thanks for watching. Cheerio.